With that, I do, we want to take a look at Joe. Not really going to discuss his wife much, but the life of Joe. And it's one, it's a story that goes through history. It was a very poetic story that everybody knows, everybody's heard, whether they've been in church or not. The story of Joe is not. There was the challenge, there was the between Satan and God. Whether or not Job would curse God if he was being tested. If he wasn't being blessed, or if he didn't have God's protection around him, Satan believed that he would curse him. Just because you've been protecting him, you've been taking care of him his whole life, everything's still been so easy for him. If you take that away, he will curse you. So Job was described as a blameless, righteous man who honored God. And eventually he would lose all of his livestock, he would lose all of his servants, and he would lose his children, all these, to death. And later on he would have sores and boils all over his body. Which at that point, he did curse the day that he was born, and he cursed his own life. As you go through the story, there's a lot of dialogue. That's the bulk of the story of Job. There's a lot of dialogue back and forth between him and his friends, trying to figure out what did he do? Trying to figure out what's happened. Why are you sick? Why did you lose everything you have? Why are you laying here with boils, boils and sores all over you? And what it came down to was a lot of talk and what did you do? And then God answered. What kind of sin do you have in your life that would cause God to do this to you? And this is much like the story of Jesus when he hired to heal the blind man. They asked him, okay, who sinned in this man's life? Did this man sin? Or was it his parents that sinned that he was cursed with blindness in most of his life? And it's the same thing that's going on here. Was it the sin in life in Job's life? As we go through, we get into chapter 29, and Job is in an incredible amount of pain, in distress, and of course he's going to be in mourning. He's lost his children. He's lost everything that he had. At this point, he is demanding an explanation from God. And starting out, he talks about how God took care of him, what his life was like. In the 29th chapter, it says, how I long for the months gone by, for the days when God watched over me, when his lamp shone on my head, and by his light I walked through darkness. Oh, for the days when I was in my prime, when God's intimate friendship blessed my house, when the Almighty was with me, my children were around me, when my path was drenched with cream, and the rock poured out for me streams of olive oil. Just going back, he's going to start building up his case. What he's saying here is, God, you were with me. You were blessing me. You know, everything was great. Everything was going fine. There's no problems. And as he goes along, he starts talking about what a good person he is. He says, the man who was dying blessed me. I made the widow's heart sing. I put on righteousness as my clothing. Justice was my robe and my turban. I was eyes to the blind. I was feet to the lame. I was a father to the needy. I took up the case of the stranger. I broke the fangs of the wicked and snatched the victims from their teeth. Now he's, okay, I had such a great life when you were with me before. And then, look at all I do. Look at everything that I do. I take care of the people around me. Everybody likes me. I'm a very charitable person. I make sure that everybody is taken care of. And he goes on. This will take three chapters where Job is going to build his case up. And as he goes along, it seems to get a little bit more angry. And it starts to turn into more of an accusation than just a plea for an explanation. He said, I cry out to you, O God, but you do not answer. I stand up, but you merely look at me. You turn on me ruthlessly. With the might of your hand, you attack me. And he continues to get more poignant with his speech, more accusations towards God. He says, if I have walked in falsehood, or my foot has hurried after deceit, and here's a big statement, let God weigh me in honest scales. But he's telling God that he's not even using an honest scale to judge him with, that this is some sort of undeserved situation that he is in. And he will know that I am blameless. If my steps have turned from the path, if my heart has been laid, my eyes or my hands have been defiled, then may others eat what I have sown, and may my crops be uprooted. But here we are. If I've done anything wrong, yeah, you're justified. Take it away from me. Go ahead and do it. He says, oh, that someone would hear me. Somebody would listen to me. I now sign my defense. Let the Almighty hear me. Let my accuser put his indictment in writing. And then it says, in the chapter, it says, the words of Job have ended. You can see this. Here's your mic drop as he walks away. If he could walk, if he wasn't so faint. But he's putting this to God. You judged me unrighteously. You held things against me. I'm blameless. You have no right to do this to me. You've seen everything that I've done. And you know that I'm righteous. You have no right to do this to me. And after this, we see another one of his friends come and to give his reason. And he's saying, it's not because you have sinned, because you're going to sin. You're going to do something, and this is a warning from God. Don't do it. But he's saying, God killed his children, his servants, his livestock, and made him sick and putting them in pain because he was going to sin. So he's cutting him off in the past. So why is Job a blameless, righteous man who honored God? Suffering. And we've all had a why me moment. Why is this going on? Why does this have to happen to me? And this isn't an exclusive thing that's just going to happen to Christians. This goes on with everybody, whether you're in the church or not, saved or not. At some point in our life, we're going to say, why me? Why did this have to happen? No matter how big or small the problem or the trial or issue, a lot of times it's perspective. We could have some minor issue in our lives, and it seems, you know, it's the old mountain out of a molehill thing. And at some point, we're going to say, I really don't deserve this. Why am I in this situation? And as Job said, I do this. I don't do these things I'm not supposed to. I give, I pray, I serve, I go to church, and yet I'm in a mess. An undeserved mess. Why is this going on in my life? And Job used all the same reasons that we would use, all the same reasons that we have. Everybody liked it. He did good things. And yet, we still suffer. To one degree or another. But if you haven't suffered, good news, you will. So what's the purpose? What's the point of all the suffering? For some people, for those who have not trusted in Christ, for those who don't believe in Jesus as their Savior, something that would come on them, a trial, some sort of issue would be to show them that they need Christ, show them that they need God in their life, that they need a Savior. But depending on that person, a lot of times it chases them away. They become more angry at God than they were in the beginning, and it chases them away. Even though the purpose of what they may be going through is to simply show them that they need Christ, show them that they need a Savior. And they'll talk about that, something similar to that in Revelation, where they said that they would have the boils and the sores, and God would put this, and they cursed him all the more. Even when God showed his power and showed him who he was, they would still curse him. We've got to see through some of our trials that we need Jesus. And much like for the Christian, how the law, or through the Mosaic law in the Old Testament, was the law was put there to show us that we could not achieve perfection on our own, that we needed someone to show us that we were in sin, that we could not follow this law perfectly. But as Christians, our suffering has a different level. It has a different purpose. In Acts, it says, the strengthening of the disciples and encouraging them to remain true to the faith. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. We have to suffer. Christ suffered. And the more and more that we become like Christ, the more the world's going to hate us, and the more trials and the more issues that we're going to come into in our lives. Corinthians, Paul says, we are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. Paul's saying that we're going to be persecuted, we're going to have these problems, but we are not abandoned. The key through all this trial, through the suffering, it's going to happen. We're going to have mental, physical, emotional, spiritual issues that we're going to have to deal with in this life, or any combination of those things, but not abandoned. And a true Christian life is really not for the faint of heart. A lot of people that will fall away don't actually get the real gospel when they were told. When they come to Christ, they're not getting the full gospel. They talk about how great it is to be a Christian, how things are going to go great, the problems are going to be solved because Jesus is the answer, and that's all you need. But they don't know that we're going to go through all the trials. Jesus said of Paul, he will see how much he must suffer for my cause, for my sake. Johnny Cash, later on in his life, said, being a Christian is not for sissies. It takes a real man to live for God. A lot more of a man than to live for the devil. So our suffering will have a point. It will have a purpose. It'll build up and strengthen the body. It builds community. Galatians says that we carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. When somebody in the body, somebody in the congregation is having an issue, no matter what the problem is, we are to bear each other's burdens. We're supposed to circle around that person, lift them up, edify that person, encourage them through their time. Our suffering helps us to encounter other people. We identify. If I've been through a situation, now I know that this person is going through this thing. I know how they're feeling. It helps build a ministry within the body and also evangelism to the world when I know what you've been through. When I see your suffering and I can empathize with that situation. And then if I follow what Paul is saying here, that we carry each other's burden, we lift each other up and carry each other through the situation. So the body of Christ becomes stronger, and if we use this as our evangelism, it also brings more into the body. And like Job, through our suffering, we have the choice, do we trust in God or do we curse him for our problems and our situations? Can I worship through the pain? Can I trust God when everything is going wrong? When it seems like he's abandoned me, when it seems like I'm alone and I'm going through a situation, can I still worship? If we can look back to what Paul said again, I am not abandoned. And our suffering in this life, whatever it may be, prepares us for eternity. But whatever we went through in this life, whatever the problems they are, it makes eternity all the much better. Our time with Christ in heaven will be all the more glorious after what we've been through. 2 Corinthians says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes on not what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, and what is unseen is eternal. back to Job and his explanation, on demand for an explanation. So after all this, God will respond to Job. It says, then the Lord answered Job out of the storm, and he said, who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man, and I will question you, and you shall answer me. Probably not a great way for God to start a conversation with him. When you have the Almighty Creator said, stand up like a man, nothing good afterwards is going to happen. Where were you when I laid the foundation, the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you would know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and the angels shouted for joy. And God goes on for 129 verses telling Job what he's done and asking him, do you understand what I've done? Were you there that I might ask you for counsel? God, in his own words, lays out his own resume. How do you respond to that? Job was given questions that he could barely understand, let alone respond to. But God gives him that opportunity to respond. Job answered, I am unworthy, and how can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth. I spoke once, I have no answer. Twice, and I will say no more. The Lord will continue to go on with Job, asking him questions. And then Job says, you said, listen, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer. My ears have heard you, but now my eyes have seen you. Job was a God-fearing man. He did what he was supposed to do. He was obedient. He did all the things he was supposed to do. And he says, I have heard of you, but now I see you. Now I know who you are. I know you now. Before I had just heard. I've heard of you. And Job is still inflicted with his voice. He's still sick. He still has the sores all over his body. And he's realizing who God truly is. Seeing his eyes are clear now that I know who you are. I went through the suffering. And he can truly look on the Father for who he is and what he is. Now my eyes have seen him. Through a time of suffering, we get to know not only ourselves, but we get to know the Father also. We've all been through some sort of situation, some painful situation that we've had to call on God, that we've had to really bear down, and it's not just, oh, I can handle this situation, where we're actually in a situation where we absolutely know that we have God, and there's nothing that's going to get us through it without prayer and scripture. There's no atheist in a foxhole thing, where we know that we need him. And a lot of times after we've gotten through that, and we've gotten past what our problem is or our situation is, a lot of times we can look back on that and realize the closeness that we had with the Father during that time of trial, during that time where I knew I had no other place to go. So Job finishes up this phrase, but now my eyes have seen you, therefore I despise myself, and I repent in dust and ashes. God had never left him, and he came out more blessed than he was before. But a lot of times when we start trying to trail off on how much we need God, how much we have to have him with us, how much we need Christ. And then when we get that reality check, therefore I despise myself. through all of this, through the entire story of Job, he never got his answer. He was never told why. And a lot of times we won't have that why. We won't get it. All we know is what happened. We have no reason. We have no way of knowing how or why. But we have to trust in God's sovereignty. That's where our faith comes in. Even though we're going through some problem, I'm going through a trial or some situation, I have to have faith to know that he has control over all of these things. And know ultimately, regardless of the situation, God will be glorified. It does not matter. Whether we want to fight him or we want to follow him, God will be glorified. But the more we get to know him, if we're actually able to trust in his sovereignty, trust in who he is, will be blessed, as Job was blessed later on, as he persevered. James says, blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Through every situation, good or bad, we always have that choice. Am I going to trust God, or am I going to fight him and do my own thing? Am I going to curse him with my words and my actions? In a time of trial, rather than why, what am I supposed to learn? How am I going to glorify God? What am I supposed to learn through this that's going to make me more like Christ? Because that's going to be the reason that we're going to go through anything, is that it's going to make us more like Christ, draw us closer to the Father, and glorify him. As we come into a time of communion, think of the situations that we've gone through, how we handled it, how we handled our sin, how we handled our times of trial. Do we praise him? Do we worship him even though things aren't going my way? Knowing that he will not and has not abandoned us, but he's there for us and he's there to strengthen us. And he loved us so much that he gave his son, showing what he was willing to do to have us with him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you that we can know through your word that you are with us always. You will not leave us. You're not going to abandon us. We know that we'll have to go through trials. We'll have to go through situations. But we'll have you for eternity in your glory. We thank you for the sacrifice you've given. And Jesus, that gave himself to be my